Morning, ladies and gentlemen. I am not from industry. My association with drones starting during my research at the Center for APAR Studies, where I studied aviation and drone ecosystem, authored a few research articles, and published a book called India's Quest for UAVs and Challenges. During my research, I discussed some of the ideas of creating drone testing sites, laying down of airworthiness standards, pursuing research and development of enabling technologies, and formulating a forward-looking regulatory framework. In India, Sri Lalchand Heerachand laid the foundation of military aviation manufacturing in December 1940. However, civil aviation manufacturing never took off. The promulgation of Drone Regulation 1.0 in August 2018 changed this trend and set the tone for stimulating drone manufacturing in India. It had some of the forward-looking provisions which you are all aware of. Ministry of Civil Aviation proactively constituted a task force to give recommendations for promulgating a forward-looking Drone Regulation 2.0, which in future is expected to help take India in becoming a leading manufacturer, developing futuristic applications and exploiting their potential. But manufacturing is a difficult path where industry, regulators and policy makers have to dream and work against all odds as a team, which India is experiencing in the ongoing drone revolution. And once you cross these hurdles, manufacturing is a rewarding proposition, provided we translate our dreams and policy pronouncements into action. However, devil lies in details, and to understand the progress, challenges, and solutions to promote drone manufacturing in India, we have a prominent panel, eminent panel with Mr. Akash Sinha as CEO Omnipresent Robot Technologies, Mr. Ravi Kiran from Dassault Systems, Mr. Neil Mehta from Asteria, Lieutenant Colonel Navleen Nehlani from Idea Forge, and Mr. Sanjeev Trehan from Tremble. I would urge my panel to share their experiences, identify challenges, but more importantly, recommend measures so that we can move forward. So I have one few common questions so that we all are on one platform when we discuss drone manufacturing in India. The first is, what are the challenges of airworthiness and testing, use of testing sites for R&D, and how can we improve them? What specific measures do we need to take to make a certification system responsive and expedite the process? And Mr. Ravi Kiran, specifically to you, I would ask you, what technological inputs are needed for stimulating and scaling up of the drone manufacturing? And Mr. Trehan, what are the limitations of drone manufacturing and what needs to be done? So without much ado, I invite Akash to start the proceeding.
Thank you so much, sir. You know, when it comes to manufacturing, I just wanted to share my experience. There are a lot of challenges, and you know, one of the biggest challenges is to see, you know, manufacturing is capital intensive, you know, and where you get the capital from. So, you know, of course, one way is to raise a lot of funds. You know, Neil can definitely tell you about that. And then there is, but the route that we took was we tied up with a state government. And this is something that is worth exploring. You know, we had signed some contracts like worth over $5 million already. And those involved creating joint manufacturing facilities, testing facilities, and so forth. The another challenge that I see a lot of entrepreneurs miss out is, even if you start manufacturing, where exactly are you giving a differentiator that is based on value? So, you know, creating a drone might be easy enough for a lot of you budding entrepreneurs, but have you thought, you know, why wouldn't someone else be able to create the same drone? And what is the advantage you're giving that others might find difficult to give? And that's where, you know, what we decided was to mix a layer of software in our hardware. You know, so when you're manufacturing, especially drones, in hardware, how can you mix software to do that? Huh? That's another thing to look at. And the place where we operate mostly, which is, you know, industrial plants and so forth, we've been probably deployed in more than, I would say, 40 to 50 industrial plants across India already. And the place where we found our differentiator was that we were mixing our software so that the clients could get their analytics faster than anyone else who were offering. So that's another consideration. Now, coming back to the sites, the question that sir raised about the where to fly. Now, we looked at these innovative drones Hubble Fly just made, and you look at the range. You know, the range is 5 kilometers. Now, in order to be able to fly and test such drones, one of the things that DGC has done is to allow university premises to be used as test sites, if I'm not wrong. So one of the things we did was when we were working with a state government, we said, you have a huge university campus that's about 1,000 acres, and you know there isn't much activity happening. So why don't we use that as a test site? And you know, those are some of the things that can be done, that you can do as an entrepreneur. Obviously, DGC also needs to do a little more on this front. Then, of course, coming back to manufacturing, you know, having said that, all these challenges, let's go back, and we heard the secretary this morning that manufacturing is going to be one of the biggest opportunities in drone space. So I didn't want to deter any entrepreneur here. It's going to be the biggest, you know, one of the biggest spaces in drone industry. However, there will be challenges.
Thank you, Akash, for being short and crisp. Mr. Ravi Kiran, could you pitch in with your good remarks?
Very good afternoon to all of you. I must tell you that I'm really encouraged to see so many budding entrepreneurs in drone industry. I didn't realize till I came here that drone industry is going to be such a big, vibrant industry. And thank you very much, sir, for giving us this opportunity. Dassault Systems is a technology company. It is an offshoot of Dassault Aviation. So we think we are very well associated with aerospace. But until I came here, I didn't realize that I didn't know much about drones. So first disclaimer, whatever I speak is a little knowledge that I acquired having read a lot of about drones, but not really working with many drone companies. So technology plays a significant role. So here I'm going to talk about how technology can enable or enhance drone manufacturing capability and ecosystem in India. When in the morning, secretary was talking about drones becoming cars of next generation, right? Probably in 10 years down the lane, we'll be seeing a lot of drones flying like the way cars are running on the roads. So the cars, the typically aerospace industry, the manufacturing cycles are very long. But cars are produced every 60 seconds. There is a car that is thrown out of an assembly plant. If drones were to be like that, and you have to produce drones with the capacity, configurability, and in the volumes that the countries are looking for in the next 10 years, then they have to adopt new technologies and a lot of compliance in terms of producing with more robustness and digital validation techniques, digital design, digital validation techniques that have to be incorporated in drone design as well as manufacturing. That's the first point I would like to make. And second point is I have learned that drones are of various sizes, various weights. Can drones look at one drone delivering various functions? So that there comes the question of configurability. So without having to change the drones for each and every application, I create one platform of drones and keep varying maybe the surveillance cameras or whatever that you put down below. Just the platform is the same, but you're using it for various applications just by reconfiguring it. That will simplify the capacity of drones and then also reduce the cost of ownership for many of the drone operators. not the drone manufacturers, but the drone operators. That's the configurability aspect I would like to highlight. That's where the technology can be leveraged. And the third point I would like to tell, share to you all is that the way you have, in the first half, there is a partnership that DFI has announced with AWS. AWS is providing you probably the services to get the data access and the servers or whatever that they're providing. We are also in consultations with the ministry and the other concerned government officials to see if we can set up a technological infrastructure on cloud base, wherein these budding entrepreneurs who doesn't have the wherewithal or the money or the capital to invest into these high-end technologies can access these technologies, design various kind of drones digitally, validate them digitally, and also see if it what kind of functions it will deliver once it's manufactured. So in short, what we are trying to propose or offer, if our discussions fructify, is to create a digital twin of the drones. Creating a digital twin of the drones so that your drones, you can realize the potential of your drones even before you physically produce them. So that's one point I would like to extend the invitation to all of you. All the budding drone entrepreneurs, we will be organizing one workshop. Probably the DFI will reach out to you in next 1 month's time. In this workshop, we would like to encourage you to see how these technologies can be leveraged for your design and development process, and also to see how the manufacturing effectiveness can be brought into your drones. These are the three points I would like to share.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Ravi. Now, may I invite Neil to offer his remarks.
Hi, good afternoon, everyone. I'm one of the co-founders of Asteria Aerospace. We are one of the design developers and manufacturers of drones, primarily for surveillance and security applications at the moment. I started the company in 2011, incorporated in 2011, but we started operations in early 2012. And primarily focused on design development and manufacturing, started with subsystems of drones, the autopilot, the ground control software, and then finally moving into airframes and the entire systems. So from two people, me and my co-founder, we are up to about 75 people today. And happy to say that about a little over half of those people are in the product development side, in the engineering side. So I would just like to share some of the experiences that we've had as a designer, developer, and manufacturer, and some of the challenges that we face, and how people who are starting out can try to overcome them. So the first thing is, I'd like to just kind of broadly define manufacturing, activity that we are talking about here as not just, taking parts from a knockdown kit and assembling it, but more of owning the intellectual property of what you're manufacturing. So owning the design and development process and activity that you're doing to actually make this system, right? Because you are not, building a company, or you should not be thinking of building a company just to make one single equipment. You should be making a company that can make products and that, is going to be sustainable for a lifetime. So, what you should be looking to control and what we should be trying to encourage the Indian ecosystem here is to have more companies that actually do design and development of these systems here. And there are challenges. We'll talk about some of them and how to overcome them. But fundamentally, the idea should be that you should know, what goes into the system. You should know where the parts are coming from. You should be able to do quality control of your suppliers. And so it's not an easy, thing to do. When we talk about manufacturing, you need to control everything from inventory to stores to, supply chain to quality control, establishing processes where you know in the end product, where every single piece of screw came from and when it was purchased, and you can trace it back to the supplier and do quality control. So that's the scope that we are talking about, and that's what we should try to achieve towards. It's not easy, I would say. So I would say there are about 20 to 30 companies in India that are actually manufacturing drones. But out of that, maybe about 75% would have not made more than 20 drones of a single model. And few of them would have made about more than 50, and very few would have made more than 100. And when you try to scale, you know, your processes, you know, you are going to face challenges. You are going to have to establish all these different, you know, parts of the ecosystem, which you should be starting to think right now, and how you're going to do that. If we really have to develop an ecosystem in India, we need to, everyone here who's looking to get into drones needs to start thinking about how you're going to scale this, right? You're not here to make one or two prototypes. You can do that, and I think, like Akash said, that's not a value differentiation because anyone, can do that as part of a college project. But how do you scale that, and how do you make it, sustainable as a company? Investment, it is going to be challenging. People investing in hardware products in India is not very common. And you are going to face challenges there. I would say there are two solutions to this. First is probably pick one niche and focus there. Don't try to do everything under the sun. Pick one area where you would like to focus on. Maybe it's spraying, maybe it's defense, maybe it's surveying, mapping, or maybe it's within surveying, maybe it's a LiDAR drone. But pick one specific application, try to manufacture a product for a market there, and build your capabilities around that, then try to scale it towards other applications. I'll make it easier for you to establish your foothold as well as for people to invest in. Secondly, I think the government can do a lot more here. In the US, in our other countries, there are programs that the government runs to promote small businesses, right? And this is the only really way for us to scale this, right? There are small, I think Akash would know maybe, small SBIR, so small business innovation research. The government picks, funds projects in companies to develop certain capabilities. And I think this is a solely needed point here. The government should not really just put more funds in DRDOs and the PSUs, but try to encourage innovation in smaller companies where people are more willing, more hungry to try out these things and make companies out of it. So, you can get anywhere between $100,000 to maybe $300,000, $400,000 in innovation research grants from the government in the US. And I think that is something that we solely need here because VCs are not going to just, fund these kind of projects. So I think that government can do a lot more on the investment side. Secondly, I think on the supply chain side, right? So one of the reasons why people hesitate to go into kind of design development ecosystem here is, there's all things available from China. Why can't I just buy a drone here and use it? There are a few problems there. One is you don't own any of the IP. So next time if a customer asks you to make a variant of it, for some other, for different purpose, you will not be able to meet that. You will have to go back to the, your Chinese supplier. Secondly, I think like Hubblefly said, you can't provide that kind of customer support to your customers as well if you're just depending on another supplier. And I think thirdly, I think the ecosystem as a whole does not benefit out of that at all in India. If you're trying to scale manufacturing here, we should be looking at adding some value differentiators. Of course, a service industry can use whatever product it best sees for providing a service. But if you're looking to scale manufacturing, then I think we need to start developing some of those ecosystems here. Maybe it's battery assembly. It's okay if the cells are not made in India. They could be assembled in India at least. And start looking from there and then move on to maybe the next step would be actually manufacturing cells. So it's a step-by-step process. Everything is not going to be made in India, but your design development should be with you and you should be very clear about where you can find a strategic partner for some of these things and where you can add value differentiator to your customers. So for example, we focus on a system level design, right? We try to maximize performance of the drone. So we try to maximize endurance. We try to make it very easy for our customers to use our drones. So we want to train, you know, someone who's not even seen a computer in their life flying a drone in 4 days, like in the police force. So those are things that add value differentiator. How do we make it very easy for them to, you know, adopt this technology? It's not that we need to make all the individual parts, all the motors and things in India, but we should be owning the system level kind of design development effort, which will allow us to kind of make, you know, products for different markets. And I think on the point of, you know, challenges in terms of certification and testing, so this is one of the areas, again, I think the government can do a lot more. There are about some test sites identified by the DGCA for allowing manufacturers to test drones. But at this moment, there's no other guidance given than one lat long, which is identified per test site. And also, there's a permission that you need to take 30 days in advance of using that test site to actually, you know, fly there, which is onerous because you would not know 30 days in advance what you're going to test there. You wouldn't want to kind of, you know, you've done some R&D, you want to fly it next day itself. So that doesn't work for the manufacturing ecosystem. And we need to do a lot more. I think there can be private test sites which can be administered by private companies, you know, authorized by the DGCA that, yeah, this airspace is blocked for testing. And, you know, people can maybe pay to use those test sites. It's a safe environment where people can go and fly. I think we need to kind of promote that ecosystem here in India. Certification, we've gone through DGCA certification ourselves. I think DGCA has laid down a fair you know, guidance in terms of what is to be expected from a drone manufacturer. They've laid down the guidelines for, you know, everything from, you know, airframe, like what kind of manufacturing processes you should follow, or rather they've asked you to provide that information, and they've also kind of listed down the broad areas where they would look at your design process, your testing process. They will ask for test reports from you. They'll ask for the manufacturing documents. They'll ask for design drawings. And that constitutes kind of a certification for an airframe. The only challenge here I see is that, yes, I think the process is laid down, but it takes a lot of time. I think there is a lack of people in the DGCA right now to handle all these applications. There are more applications I know coming in every day. And, you know, it needs to be streamlined and executed in a fast manner, which will promote, again, you know, manufacturing ecosystem here in India. But I think as a whole, you know, there are standards laid down by the DGCA, which actually encourages, I think should encourage everyone to kind of make drones for India. Because, you know, some of the compliance requirements which the DGCA has laid down, you need to have an Indian entity who's providing the NPNT software or hardware. So I think there is a fair amount of kind of ecosystem which can be developed around manufacturing in India. And I think people should take advantage of that. And now is the time really to do that. Otherwise, I think, you know, I think China is already ahead, I think, by 2 or 3 years globally of everyone in terms of, you know, small drone manufacturing. I think if we wait too long, it will be 10 years, and then there's no catching up to them at that point. So I think if we are to really put our heads together as an ecosystem and figure out how to make some of these roadblocks fall away, I think a lot more innovation can come out of India, and a lot more IP can be held in India, I think, around these sites.
Thank you, Neil. I will sum up some of the issues which he's raised, but as regards to China, I must tell you, when I was studying about China, China is not into small drone, it is into variety of drones, including into logistic supply, including into human flights. So they are moving, and I think it is time for the Indian industry to put their best foot forward. Before, now I invite Lieutenant Colonel Naveen Navlani to offer his comment.
Thank you, sir. I'm Colonel Naveen Navlani from Idea Forge. So, taking the conversation forward from what Neil and everybody has spoken, I think for all the new entrepreneurs and new startups and people with a lot of starry eyes and a lot of potential who are sitting over here, I think we need to understand that, see, there is a continuum in this drone space. On one end is, like what Neil said, is that you make a very, very customized product for a very, very specific application. And on the other side of that continuum is probably a platform, which is agnostic to the kind of application that it can be put to. Now, there is a space, jaise bolte hai na Airtel ka wo ad ki har friend zaruri hota hai. So every of these, in this whole continuum and everything in between, there is a space for everybody. So it's a decision which you need to take. You need to study the market and understand where do you, will you find your competitive edge? Do I make a product which is very, very specific to an application? Or do I make a platform which can be used for many, many applications? And, you know, I think others will also agree with me that today, as of today, if we are today sitting on 6th of January 2020, probably we ourselves don't know what all applications will come up a year or a two from now. This is a new space. This whole industry is just about what? World over, just about 9 to 10 years old. I mean, the small drones. I'm not talking about the Hales and Males, the bigger ones. It's just about 10 years old. So it is evolving on every single day. Every single day, there is a new innovation which is happening. So for somebody to get into this space and to make a mark for himself, you will have to do a market survey. You will have to see where the pain point is. What can I solve? What is the problem? And that brings me to another aspect, that is, instead of making a product, it's much better to look for solutions. Can I, what is the problem statement? Like, I come from a defense background, so I'll speak maybe much better about, you know, surveillance applications, and that happens to be probably the largest chunk of the market right now. So what is the problem statement and how I can solve with that? Having defined that, then how do I make a differentiator in the market? Now that is something which, there are two, three aspects to that. One is, of course, the technology, the specifications, and of course, at what price point I'm offering that. And that's where I, because since the question is about how do we, you know, expand this ecosystem, most of the points have already been covered. I would also like to bring one more point. And that is, once you are going to the market, to the end customer, it is very, very important to set the right expectations of the customer. Today, the customer, you know, there are ladies in this forum, but you know, at times you offer him the best of all product, and he says, kuch aur dikhao. Oh, Amazon ka that campaign was there, na, kuch aur dikhao, kuch aur dikhao. You offer him 60 minutes drone, he'll say, why not 90 minutes? Okay, fine, the industry catches up to 90 minutes. 90 minutes, nahi, why not 2.5 hours? So it's very important for us as an industry and the new entrepreneurs who are there, that there has to be a, you know, a clear communication to the end customer and to set his right expectations. That, sir, today this is where the technology is and at this price point. Now you want something which can do these 10 things? Yeah, we can make that. It is available, but it comes at a price point. Because what is going to happen is, people are comparing drones which are, you know, made, let me not say that they are made by Chinese companies, but there are dime a dozen, you go on Amazon and you see those do-it-yourself assemble kits. That comes at a price, but if you want a solution to be made out of these drones, then it comes at a price point. It comes at a price point. So two things over there. Set the right expectation of the customer, what is available today, and what will be available maybe a year hence. But today, this is what is available. And secondly, what is the price expectation? Since there was a question regarding the testing facilities, so I'm sure you would, many of you would be aware that CII and MOD, along with the government authorities, has come up with, they have decided to invest 400 crores for establishing these testing labs across India, primarily for the Northern Defense Corridor and the Southern Defense Corridor. There are challenges. I was having a discussion with Neil some time back that, of course, that would be a very good step forward. But then if they are expecting the industry also to contribute monetarily in that, that would be a little bit of a tall order, because let's accept it. Today, most of us sitting over here or over there, these are all startups. I think that's what Neil was also sharing. Whatever investment you get, probably 80% goes into your working capital. So to invest in a testing lab and money to that effect, I have my, what should I say, I have my reservations. But yes, people should be aware that these kind of testing labs and this testing infrastructure is going to come up. Government is very actively thinking of that. CII and SIDM are working towards that. And one point which I also I felt that I must bring out over here is the role of the regulator over here. See, the next, I think the Secretary Civil Aviation, he was saying that probably the, you know, every decade is for a technology, and maybe this coming decade is going to be for the autonomous. I'm not saying only for drones, but for autonomous technology. So there is a need that we need to have a regulator or a government agency and support. Like DGCA has done a wonderful job by coming out with the first set of regulations. But probably there is also a time that, it's a different beast. Autonomous, whether it is a terrestrial system or it is an aerial system or it is an underwater system, it's a totally different technological beast. And probably in the days to come, we've started with the regulations for the drones, but if we want this ecosystem to really grow up, probably we may want a integrated autonomous authority. Just imagine, sometime back, all of us must have gone to an RTO to get a license for ourselves, for our cars. Do you think that organization is capable enough to regulate about autonomous cars? Probably they don't have the wherewithal for that. DGCA has really caught up a lot, but then there is also probably a requirement. I would like other panelists to also comment on that probably you require a separate regulating authority for everything which is autonomous, whether it is in air, underwater, or on the ground, because that would be an integrated approach, and it would require probably people like all of us sitting over here to really give that technological inputs, and of course the government is going to put its weight behind that. I think that's my thoughts about how to grow this ecosystem.
He's raised very, very important point about realism in the users. Our civil aviation industry, when I studied development of aviation industry in India, that has suffered in the past because our expectations were unrealistic. We were looking at the best, and we had the potential which was probably not at that level. So when you have to grow an industry, and especially when you have a lag behind the global leaders, you have to have your expectations realistic. So I think it's a point we need to keep pondering while ensuring the user satisfaction is there. But this is one aspect. The second aspect is I'll steal a few words from what Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam used to say. You have to achieve new things with the wisdom of the past, but the energy of the youth. So whatever changes he's suggesting, the changes will come when we utilize the potential of these youngsters who are coming up with new ideas and convincing our system and the people who are in the part of the governance system that the solutions are not detrimental to the security and the safety, but they are further contributor to that. So they have to have a communication which is acceptable and understandable by the old guards. So thank you very much. Now I move to Mr. Sanjeev Tehan.
Sir, if you will allow me to interject, with due regards to you, I don't agree that Indian technology is anywhere behind anywhere in the world.
Oh, wow.
We have fantastic technology over here. This is the actually the mindset which has to change. Today, this also percolates down to your investors also. Today, anybody, what is India known for? It is for the software power. So you want investment of maybe, whatever X amount of money, everybody is ready to invest for a software-based solution. But even for hardware, look at Neil, he's made such fantastic products. We in IdeaForge, let me give you an example. Elbit system, one of the best in autonomous systems. Today, just 2 months back, they have launched a multi-rotor VTOL system, which can do 60 minutes of endurance. Now, Neil will confirm to me, we in India have been doing it for the last 5 years. So technologically, we have the technology. Indian technology is no less than, I'm not going to compare with Chinese or Israeli technology or the US technology. But in the space that we are talking of, Indian technology is, I would say, if not at par, it is a shade better than the world technology. It's only for us to have belief in ourselves. Sorry, I interjected.
No, absolutely fine. I must compliment him. And this confidence is required. And again, it's a matter of dialogue and communication. The communication has to be right. Most of us have a fad for imported products. So somewhere around the line, I think then communication has to be correct where your strengths are there. But at the same time, you must ensure that one flaw of your system gets, unduly... we need to understand, we must cover those gaps so that our products do not get undue bad publicity. And we are able to ensure the quality. And one of the areas probably we miss out, which all these speakers have done, is have we been able to, after we design a product, do we have the entire records? Do we have the system? Do we have the product support where we always lack? All those aspects, if you address, I'm sure we will match the world. Now I'll invite Sanjeev to offer his remarks.
Thank you very much. It's always a pleasure to go in the end because half of your job is already done. So, and then I can talk about whatever I want to talk about. anyways, look, I present Trimble. And Trimble is into many domains today. Started off as a sensor company, just providing positioning solutions. And today I'm here, and I like the belief part. I believe that in your belief, I believe in the belief of all the people who are trying to manufacture UAVs out here. And my belief is that I can support you to make it better and do it better. Having said that, the objective is that we provide positioning solutions to support manufacturing technologies in the country. Up till now, we have been working in North America, Europe, and all those places where we are supporting autonomous, we are supporting drone manufacturers, industrial manufacturers, etc., embedding positioning technologies and solutions into their ecosystems. We are working with various manufacturers in the country in all these three domains, especially UAV, to try and make sure that the industry flourishes. Small story, just take a minute. A person goes to a shop, start of the monsoons, wants to buy an umbrella. The shopkeeper says, okay, it's going to cost 30 rupees. Person, no, I'll only give you 15. After a lot of haggling, the shopkeeper says, okay, 15 is okay. You're the first sale. I don't want to spoil my day. The person says, no, now I'll only take it at 7. Well, there's a lot of argument again, a lot of haggling, etc. When shopkeeper finally agrees, okay, take it for 7. He says, no, now I'll take it for free. Again, a lot of haggling. The shopkeeper says, okay, take it for free. Then the person says, no, I'll take 2. So this is the story of our life. Now, we cannot grow if we approach business with this attitude. So a lot of the speakers out here have mentioned various factors, but we skip on certain issues which we take for granted. When you're developing a product, you have to make sure that cost is not the only factor. Right? There are a couple of points which have come out. Differentiation. What is the viability? What is the solution required, et cetera? All those things have to be taken into consideration. Unless you get the right product for the job, and if you're only scrapping the bottom of the barrel with cost, it is important. It's important for everyone. But it cannot be the sole driving factor. At times, you meet a lot of people out there in the industry, and for them, it becomes the sole criteria, and they're willing to compromise on many factors, the efficacy of the solution, et cetera, which ends up creating a product which is a me-too product. And over a period of time, you cannot sustain your business. Another aspect I like to highlight over and above what the gentlemen have mentioned is awareness. I come from a different background. You know, I have marketed, I've sold drones as well, so I understand the domain from that aspect. And I'm today supplying solutions which go inside a drone ecosystem. So having said that, people need to have awareness of what is out there in terms of sensors, et cetera. Although the awareness has grown thanks to a lot of interactions that take place, thanks to internet, et cetera, but people need to understand what is the right solution which meets their requirement. And partly the industry, including me as well, we had the shortcoming of not creating that awareness. What is the right solution for the job? So we do a lot of cut and paste job. We pick what is easily available, accessible, et cetera, and paste it into our solutions. Ultimately, what happens is that when it comes to the proof of the concept or when it goes out in the field, somebody somewhere will get disinterested once they don't get the desired results. So please be careful when you go out and create a solution and market it, because you have to make sure that it fits the requirement. Otherwise, it ends up impacting the entire industry per se as such. Scale and volume is something that Neil mentioned. That's definitely an issue in this country. I've had a chat with a lot of VCs also who wanted some inputs regarding this particular industry. And scale is a chicken or the egg story. What comes first? Whether we create the scale and then get the funding in, or whether we get the funding in, then we create the sale. So this story will keep on going. Each and everyone will have to define their own path to whatever way to success. But one important element is that we all need to collaborate, right? In different capacities. I have operated in multiple segments, multiple sectors, multiple industries over the last few years. Collaboration, there's no substitute for. Whether it is collaboration with the industry, and Girish Kumarji mentioned in the morning, you have to collaborate with your customer. You have to collaborate above and below the value chain. You have to collaborate with the OEM, in my case, the GNSS solution provider, or the GNSS board provider, which goes into the system. You have to collaborate with some software manufacturer. The only way you can overcome the obstacles is if you collaborate. If you don't collaborate, you'll be out there fending for yourself only. So these are some of the points that I wanted to bring out. Apart from that, I can't being a typical there's a BD in front after my name, yeah? Business development, sales. So I have to do that bit also. So basically the way we are looking ourselves, positioning ourselves in the country is to try and assist all UAV manufacturers with quality solutions, quality positioning solutions for their applications. There are multiple applications. So those of you interested, you can take a look at a booth outside, Trimble booth outside. What is more important is it has to be collaborative again. So our ethos is not to just sell it and forget it, but to collaborate through the development cycle, et cetera, and the production cycle. That is what the ethos is. That's what we try to bring to the table. And hopefully, we are working with already many manufacturers locally, and hopefully we can scale it up as well as they scale up. So your scaling up is going to help us scale up, and ultimately help us make in India as well down the road. One last point, carrying forward from the pre-inaugural session. Please do not be afraid of regulation. You see, I faced regulation with the GNSS industry as back as 96, 97, 98. GPS was a banned entity. And you have to use regulation to your advantage. the glass is half full or it's half empty. Right? Regulation will help organizations who have a sustainable roadmap to survive. Create your business plans around the regulation. Otherwise, every second person will become a trader. So look at from that point of view. You'll have a competitor next door every second day opening up and closing up. And it'll give a bad name to the drone industry per se as such. So take it as a what you call pill. Have it, whether we like it or not. May not taste wonderful all the time. But use it to your advantage to create competitive advantages against someone who's just importing a piece of equipment from abroad and selling it out here. Thank you very much.
Now, I would love to have questions, but since time is less, I would use the privilege of a chair to sum up. One, if we look at delays in according certification of indigenously designed drones, challenges in operationalization of digital sky and drone training schools, teething problems in issuing of UIN, UAOP, absence of single window clearance mechanism for drone licenses, procedures for utilization of testing sites indicates there's a large span of implementation challenges. And it's a part of our growth. And to overcome these challenges, DGCA is working, but the only thing is we need to expedite this process. One aspect probably which I would like to highlight is, and probably it has not caught the attention, is taxation. I think this is one aspect when I was studying civil aviation MRO industry that has suffered, because once your industry picks up and your domestic taxation is higher, your domestic industry becomes less competitive. And once it becomes less competitive, drone manufacturing is going to see the fate what civil aviation industry is there. And that aspect, you as a professionals and probably, you know, need to interact and find solutions. Because in my understanding, GST on civil aviation was higher than the one if you imported the MRO. So those aspects have to be taken into at this stage when drone industry is evolving. And I would urge all of you to study little closely on the nuances of taxation. And I would also like to raise this point emerged. I think drone industry in India has been commendably led by startups. However, they're only producing, as of now, certified ones, micro and mini drones, which are weighing up to 25 kgs. That will not give us scalability. I think time has come to expand this business sphere and larger Indian industries to invest and enter into not assembly alone, but design, development, and manufacturing of drones. That will make the things like logistic supply, beyond visual line of sight, and swarm operations. And I think we have, nobody's spoken about swarm operations. We are facing a lot of pollution problem. I think we should put swarms as a replacement to, you know, firecracker displays. And all our operations should have drone swarms being there. And we need to propagate and develop solutions which will give us a green solution. So Diwali will have drone displays all over India. This is my dream. But I have some suggestions. When I was studying drone development in the Western world, the biggest concern, today our drones are being operated in a more or less segregated environment, if I'm not wrong, more or less. If it has to operate with the manned aircraft, if it has to operate over a populated area, or when we go for larger operations, it has to have an accident rate which is acceptable in civil aviation. For that, all your manufacturers have to develop technologies that their reliability is very high, failure rate is less. So these aspects have to be taken into consideration. And another aspect, how do you ensure safety of your communication, that it is not hacked? All those aspects have to be kept in mind when you are developing your product and when you take it to the market. And of course, investment in R&D, depending on your own scale and scope of your industry, all of you have to start thinking on investment in R&D. All these testing sites can be optimally only used if you start thinking of research and development. And of course, regulatory mechanism of 30 days of approval system is, I personally feel, needs to be reviewed at an appropriate level, and it must be done. And those who are aspiring to make in India, I would like to quote Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, who said, "Make in India initiative should not make India a low cost, low value assembly line of the world. We need to do original research to design, develop, and manufacture in India by using the ideas of the youth." And lastly, as he aptly brought out, we need to follow regulations in letter and spirit, invest in R&D to find technological solutions, and help Make in India initiative in drones a success. Thank you very much. And I would like to thank all the participants today who have not only shared their valuable insights, they have a lot of value additions. I'm sure the people who are getting into this drone or who are in the complementary domains will learn from their experiences. And those who have questions probably can interact with them and share and learn from each other. Thank you very much.
Sir, can I add just one thing? I think DFI has created a fantastic platform for all of us to come together. So there is one part of the government and regulations. And secondly, it is these kind of platforms which bring people together. And as one of our panelists was saying, that we all need to collaborate together. And this is the kind of a platform which is ideal for that. And that's how we all of us grow together. I just thought I'll add that. Thank you.